So welcome to this fifth lecture devoted to model selection. Today we shall go on with the Gaussian model selection theorem and its applications. When I say the Gaussian model selection theorem, I mean the theorem which holds for general nonlinear models and possibly nonlinear models and not only for linear models. So remember that we are working within this abstract white noise framework that we know right now very well. So you have this observation of y of j, which is merely the scalar product of an unknown quantity f with j, plus some noise, some Gaussian noise, epsilon times w of j, where w is an isonormal Gaussian process on the separable Hilbert space H. So let us begin by stating again the general model selection theorem that we have proved last time. And after that, we shall apply it to the study of a procedure which is well known in analysis and in statistics, and which is called regularization. So the statement of the theorem, of the general theorem, involves the notion of dimension that I would like to remind you. This is a notion of dimension which depends on the fluctuation of the isonormal process. And it is defined in the following way. You are looking at the supremum of the fluctuation of the isonormal process within model SM. And you normalize it by a quantity which depends on the distance between the two elements, H and J, which are involved in the increments of the isonormal process. So you normalize it in a proper way, and you want it to be under control in expectation by some quantity phi m of t, which will play the role of a modulus of continuity of the isonormal process on model SM. And after that, you define the pseudo dimension dm as a solution of the equation, which is written here. And the function phi m has the adequate property in order that this equation here has always a solution. So having defined the dimension in this way, the statement of the model selection theorem is quite easy to understand. It is the same statement as in the linear case. And it tells you that once you are given a family of weights on each model SM in a way that the sum of the exponential of minus these weights is under control. Once you are given a penalty which is large enough meaning that it has to be larger than some constant k, which has to be strictly bigger than one, times a quantity which is easy to analyze, you have the level of noise which is involved, which is epsilon square, and you have a quantity which is larger, potentially larger than the dimension itself. You would expect here to find the dimension, but you have something else. You have a quantity which is the square root of 2xm here, and which takes into account the complexity of the list of the models. So the penalty has to be larger than the quantity, which takes into account the difficulty in estimating within model SM, and which is taken into account by this term here. And it also takes into account the difficulty to estimate within the whole list. And this is this term which takes this into account. And of course, the precise shape of this quantity here is directly influenced by the Gaussian concentration theorem, as I mentioned before. So if the penalty is large enough, you may define your selection criterion, your least square penalized selection criterion, by just considering the least square at its minimum plus the penalty. And once you have done that, the corresponding penalized least square estimator, that is the estimator which is selected via this procedure here, has a performance which is given by a wristband. The wristband is here. And here it's easy to understand what is happening. You have a wristband which says that the procedure makes a trade-off between the bias, that is the distance square between the true and the model, and the penalty. And the penalty is what you have put in the machine. You find it as an output in the wristband. Okay. And you have an additional term which does not play a big role here. You have to think about capital sigma as being under control by a quantity which is 2, 3, 4, a numerical constant. So once you have done that, this summation assumption here simply says that you have something which looks like a prior probability on the list of the models. Okay, so this is a statement of the theorem. So now our purpose is to apply it to ellipsoids, because we shall see that those in this application to ellipsoids will directly allow us to analyze the L2 regularization procedure. So this is what we shall see. So as a preliminary result, in order to control the dimension, in order to apply the general model selection theorem, we need to control the dimension, the pseudo dimension, over some given ellipsoid. And this will be done through a lemma, which allows us to understand what is the behavior of the isonormal process on the ellipsoid. So this is a situation that we have already looked at when we have introduced the isonormal process. And we have already seen that the isonormal process over some ellipsoid has the following behavior. We can guarantee that there exists a continuous and bounded version of the isonormal process on some ellipsoid, if and only if this ellipsoid is Hilbert-Schmidt, which means that the sum of the side j square is finite. And in this case, we do know that there exists some continuous and bounded version of the isonormal process on the ellipsoid. And taking such a version, we have an explicit control of the expectation of the soup of the wj square over the ellipsoid. And this expectation of the soup square is exactly equal to the sum of the side j square here. So now we intend to apply this result in order to control the pseudo dimension. And the precise result that we shall prove now is the following. if you consider some Hilbert-Schmidt ellipsoid, and if we take a continuous and bounded version of the isonormal process on it, when I say bounded, it's a consequence because the ellipsoids are compact. So if you are continuous, you are bounded. So if you consider some version of the isonormal process which is continuous on the ellipsoid, then you have this control here, which looks very much as what we want, apart from the fact that we have do not subtracted W of H here. But of course, it will be a mere consequence of this result to control the increments. You will just have to multiply C by 2, and that's all. You will get the result for the increments. So we only need to prove this now. And as you will see, this is not too difficult. Let's do this. So let's turn to the proof. Of the control of the dimension on ellipsoids. So let's do that. So let's simplify a bit the notations. Let's do as if the ellipsoids were in small L2. This does not change. Let's do the identification of small L2 with capital H through the basis phi j, which merely means that we identify the sum of beta j phi j we identify it with the sequence. So this is an element of H here. And we identify it with the sequence beta j itself. So the ellipsoid is just a set of beta in small l2, such that the sum of the beta j over psi j square is less than one. This is just to simplify the notations. So now, starting from a sequence beta equal beta j in small l2, we just define a new sequence beta of x, which is merely 2x squared times beta over the norm of beta squared, the small l2 norm of beta squared, plus x squared. And now we want to see that this new element here, we want to prove that for an adequate choice of a constant C, if psi j of x equals C times psi j infimum with x, then beta of x belongs to this new ellipsoid E2 of C of X whenever beta belongs to A2 of C. This is a trick which will allow us to use the proposition that I have recalled to you. That is a proposition which allows to control the expectation of the soup of W square over some ellipsoid. So this is the trick that we want to use. So now let's see that. Let's see that it is the case with an adequate choice of C. I do have this property here, that is beta of X belongs to this new ellipsoid whenever beta belongs to the original one. So let's see that. Let's upper bound the beta J square of X. If you want to upper bound it, I pretend that beta J square of X is less than 4 times beta J square, infimum with X square times beta J square over the norm square of beta. Why is it so? It is so because you may use the fact that beta square plus X square is always larger than the maximum of X square. Of course, it is larger than X square, but it is also larger than 2 times the norm of beta times X. Those two lower bounds here hold true. Beta square plus X square is always larger than N square, okay? And it's always larger than 2 beta X, okay? So if I use that, you see that in the very definition of beta of X here, I have this weight beta square plus X square, which is involved. If I use the fact that it is that this weight is larger than X square, I use this and I end up with simply 4 beta J square here, just because I have 2 beta J to the power 2. So this gives you 4 beta J square. And if I use the other one, 2 beta x here, as the lower bound for beta square plus x square, I end up with the fact that here, the x factor will destroy the power 2 here, and this power 2 will become a power 1. But this power 1 will again become a power 2 when I take the square. So I recover this X square here, the beta J square, of course, and this norm of beta square, which comes from this lower bound here. So it's always true that beta J square of X is less than these two quantities, so it is less than the infimum. Okay, so now I turn to the quantity that I have to control, that is the sum of the beta j square of x over cj square of x. I have to prove that it is less than 1. Okay, so it is less than 1 over the constant square that I shall choose afterwards. Times what? I have the possibility of upper bounding the beta j square of x by either this quantity here or this quantity. Okay, so I can decide to take either the one or the other one. So this means that I can upper bound this by the sum of the beta j. So first I decide to upper bound this by the sum of the beta j square of x over, I use the definition of psi j square of x, of course. So I decide to upper bound it by this plus the other quantity, which is this. At this stage, what I have used is the very definition of psi j of x. Psi j of x is capital C times the infimum between psi j and x. And I have used that 1 over psi j of x is always less than 1 over capital C of the soup between 1 over psi j and 1 over x, but the soup is always less than the sum. Which is less than one of the over psi j. I have to put squares. Square plus one over x square. This is what I have done. And so now I may this time use the upper bound that I have established here. In a clever way, that is, you see that I have here, when I look at beta j square of x over psi j, it's better to use the first upper bound. So it is less than 1 over capital C square times the 4 times the sum of beta j square over psi j square plus in the second situation, I just have to use the second one. And the second one, as you see, the x square will cancel and the norm square will also cancel. That is, I see that here there is x square over x square, which cancel. And I have the sum of the beta j square over the norm square. So at the end of the day, what I get is that here, this quantity is less than one. And here, because beta belongs to the ellipsoid, this quantity is less than one also. So finally, I get 1 over c square times 5 whenever beta belongs to E2 aussi. And so it remains to choose capital C as the square root of 5. and this is okay to get one. And so this means that beta of x does belong to E2 of C of x as it was announced. And this means that because of the proposition that I have recalled to you, this means that the expectation of the soup of W of beta of x when beta belongs to E2 of C square is less than the expectation of the soup in the ellipsoid C of x of W of gamma square, which is equal to the sum of the beta j, which is equal to the sum, excuse me, of the psi j of x square. And the sum of the psi j of x square equals 5 times the sum of psi j square minimum of x square. And this gives you the final result. Okay, so the proof now is completed. And we have this corollary in our pocket that we can use. So now we shall consider as a collection of models, the collection of those ellipsoids which are homothetic of a given one. So I take some R which is larger than 1/2 in order to warrant that I have a Hilbert-Schmidt ellipsoid. And I look at basically the ellipsoid with radiuses given by the sequence J to the power minus R. And I put some multiplier here, M times epsilon, which allows me to discretize the more natural collection of ellipsoids that I would like to see, that is a collection of ellipsoids which are homothetic of the ellipsoid, the basic ellipsoid given by the sequence G to the power minus R. So I have this multiplier here, which is capital R, and I look all the ellipsoids which are homothetics of a given one, but I discretize this collection in order to be in the framework of our theorem, that is a countable family of models and not a continuous family of models. So I look at this discretization. And now what I pretend is that the pseudo dimension of each of these ellipsoids here is merely m to the power 2 over 2r plus 1 up to some constant here. So this means that the level of discretization that I have chosen makes sure that the pseudo dimension does not depend on epsilon. Okay, This is exactly what happens. So I, of course, I have to use the preceding results, the corollary. And if I use this corollary, I may take as a function phi m to control the fluctuation in the definition of the pseudo dimension. I may take it as the function square. I may take it as 20 times this sum here. Why 20? It's 5 multiplied by 4 in order to warrant that the increments stay in the ellipsoid. But never mind, do not pay attention to this 20. It's just to have an explicit result. So you have this 20 times the sum of what? The sum of the radiuses square of the ellipsoid, infimum with x square. So it's simply, I simply used the result that I have stated before, the corollary, and the definition of the pseudo dimension, which involves this function phi m. So I may take this phi m like that. And now I have to compute this phi m, or more precisely, to upper bound it. And to compute it, to upper bound it, I just notice that provided that x is not too large, x stays smaller than m times epsilon, then this sum here is nothing else than x squared times n plus this sum, just because, of course, as long as x is smaller than this, then this is x which appears in the sum. It appears capital N times times, where capital N is the very set where the x stays smaller than the radius. So you have x squared times n which appears. And after that, this is the radius which is smaller than x. And this is the sum of the radiuses square which appears. So this sum here is really equal to this one. And now to compute the order of magnitude of this sum here, it's quite easy. We use the definition of capital N, and we see from this definition that approximately, you see that the order of magnitude of capital N, in order to find it, I solve the equation x equal, approximately equal to m epsilon capital N to the power minus r. And if I do that, I find that capital N is m epsilon over x to the power 1 over r. So this is one thing. The other thing is that I upper bound the sum of this Riemannian series here by the classical way, that is, I look the comparison with an integral, and it is less than 1 over 2r minus 1 times capital N to the power minus 2r plus 1. And so this leads to some evaluation where the very value here, which comes from the definition which is there, the very value of capital N, is such that I discover that it is such that the order of magnitude of x squared times capital N, which is this term here, is exactly the same as the order of magnitude of the upper bound of this one. And so this means that at the end of the day, the order of magnitude of the whole sum here is given by, up to constant, of course, by the order of magnitude which is common to these two terms here, this one and this one. Oops. Sorry. Okay. And this order of magnitude is simply this one that I put here. Okay, so at the end, what you find is that you may take the function phi m of x, which controls the fluctuation of the isonormal process over the ellipsoid when I renormalize this fluctuation by the convenient quantity which is involved in the definition of the dimension. This phi m of x can be taken as a constant times what? Times x to the power 1 minus 1 over 2r, and times a quantity which is m epsilon to the power 1 over 2r. And now it remains to solve the equation which gives you the pseudo dimension. So if we solve this equation, which is here, then we end up with dm, which no longer depends on epsilon and which is of order m to the power 2 over 2r plus 1, exactly as announced. And I just give you the details of the solution of the equation here. This value of dm comes from the fact that when you look at the equation which is here, if you solve this equation, you end up with the fact that the epsilon here cancel. And at the end of the day, dm is a power, is of order a power of m, which is this one exactly. That is m to the power 2 over 2r plus 1. Okay, these are quite tedious calculations, but they are not difficult. And finally, we have a formula for the pseudo dimension of an ellipsoid of the collection. And now we will apply the model selection theorem. We just use the weights which are of the same order of magnitude as the pseudo dimension that we have computed. It's enough. And if the penalty is greater than some constant, which is well chosen, times m to the power 2 over 2r plus 1 epsilon squared, then the risk bound that we find is simply that the quadratic risk of the selected estimator is up to constant controlled by the infimum between the distance square between f and the model SM and the penalty computed at m. Okay, so this is a statement which is at the end quite simply to understand. And we see that the role of the usual dimension in the linear case is here played by this m to the power 2 over 2r plus 1. So this is quite easy to analyze. And now, if we take the penalty exactly of the right order, that is of the order of the constraints that we have on it, then we discover that if the true belongs to some of the ellipsoids here, you have an upper bound, of course, which is of order of the penalty because the bias is equal to zero. And this upper bound here is merely m to the power 2 over 2r plus 1 epsilon squared. Wait a minute. We know what is the order of magnitude of the minimax risk over some given ellipsoid. This is the computations that we have done before. So the issue is now, is this quantity of the right order? Is it of the order of the minimax risk on the ellipsoid? And the answer is yes, just because if you compute the lower bound on the ellipsoid that we have at hand, remember that the ellipsoid that we have at hand have radiuses psi j equals m epsilon times j to the power minus r. So the formula for the lower bound of the minimax risk is just the sup over d of the radiuses square, but the radiuses square make epsilon square appear exactly as in the d epsilon square. So I can put the epsilon square in front of the formula, and I end up with m square times d to the power minus 2r infimum with d. And of course, this is equal to m to the power 2 over 2 r plus 1 epsilon square, or more precisely, this is of order, this quantity, to constant as usual, just because if you solve the equation m square d to the power minus 2r equal d, you end up with this value here. So you see that it is quite satisfactory, because what we have proved right now is that the performance of the selected estimator is adaptive in the minimax sense within the collection of the ellipsoids that you have worked on. We started from a given one, and we have looked at all the discrete homothetics of this given ellipsoid. And at the end of the day, the selected estimator that we have constructed starting from our general theorem is indeed adaptive, up to constant, of course, in the minimax sense among the collection. So this is what we get as a statistical performance. So this is satisfactory in one hand, and this is a bit disappointing in the other hand, because you have made many efforts to look at ellipsoids and their dimension and so on. And we see that the performance of the resulting estimator is in some sense not better than what we had with linear models taking just the bases into order, just looking at the ordered variable selection strategy. And it's even worse in some sense, because we have only the homothetics of the given ellipsoids which are involved, and not all the possible ellipsoids. When you look at the result that we had in the linear case, when you look at when taking the ordered variable selection strategy, we had this possibility of analyzing the performance of the estimator on all ellipsoids with any possible radiuses. Here we stuck to radiuses which have a special shape, and that's all. So this is a bit disappointing. It can be shown, this is done in the notes, that as a matter of fact, the situation is not that worse. It can be shown that if you start from a quite regular ellipsoid, that is with an R, which is quite large, in fact, then it can be shown by interpolating the ellipsoids one with the others, that the playing with the bias this time, that the performance of the estimator that you have built here is adaptive among all the ellipsoids, which are slightly more rough than the original one. That is, you take all the ellipsoids with the radiuses which are j to the power minus alpha, with alpha less than r. So in some sense, the situation is better than it could appear here. But nevertheless, the main point is not there. The main point is that now we can make a connection with regularization. And as we shall see, regularization brings something new, because in this case, the estimator is explicitly computable. And so now the purpose of the game is to make appear something which is very important in modern statistics, that is to take into account the trade-off between the statistical performance and the computability of the estimators, which is quite a modern topic. So I stop here and we make a coffee break, and we shall start again by analyzing the link with regularization. So we take a coffee break during 5 or 10 minutes, and we start again. So now let us investigate the link between what we have done, that is model selection of ellipsoids, and regularization. So first, what is regularization? This is a procedure which comes from convex analysis. In the context of Hilbert spaces, it's very easy to describe. You take some linear subspace H sub R of capital H here. And this subspace is equipped with another Hilbertian norm, or more precisely, a seminorm. It's enough. It's different from the original one. And this norm is called the regularization norm. And the purpose of the game is to approximate some element of the Hilbert space by some minimizer of a quantity, which is the distance square between F and J, plus some quantity which looks like a penalty, of course, but in a continuous version. That is, you take lambda times the regularization norm square of J, and you minimize this over the space H sub bar here, the regularization space. And lambda, it's a parameter to be chosen, and of course the size of lambda will influence the value of the minimizer. And you can put more importance on the regularization norm or in the fidelity of J with respect to F, exactly as in the statistical frameworks that we have seen before. So why is it called regularization? It's easy to understand. This is a denomination which comes from the fact that the main example of this is given by the situation where H is equal to L2 of 0,1. And the regularization norm is a Sobolev seminorm. So in this case, we see that the purpose of this game is to regularize some function f, which belongs at the beginning to L2 of 0,1. And the more lambda is large, the more you regularize, and the smaller lambda, the closer the regularizer will be to the original function f. So there is some generic example which is interesting to analyze. This is the example where you take some orthonormal basis of H, some Hilbert basis of H, and you just define the seminorm by looking at the regularization seminorm and the regularization space, by looking at those functions which integrate some power of J in the sum here. And doing this, you have a weight J to the power R here, and you modify the original L2 norm by just putting a weight. So of course, you see that these forces, in order that this quantity is finite, these forces, the coefficients j, scalar products with phi j, to be smaller than for general element of the Hilbert space. And in this case, what is interesting is that you can explicitly compute the regularizer. The regularizer is given by this formula here. That is, you take the original coefficient of the function on the basis, and you modify it by divided by 1 plus lambda times j to the power 2r. And you see that this effect here goes in the following way. You just start, if lambda is what it is, it will allow you to play with it in order to make the influence of the regularization to be big or not. But in fact, it goes, it always goes in the following way. You start by keeping the coefficients for the first value of j, and then you progressively modify it. And of course, as soon as j is very large, then you see that this coefficient will be very close to zero. But this is not a zero-one choice. This is not, I keep all the coefficients and then I put it to zero. This is a more progressive way to do it. This is some kind of soft thresholding procedure. So let's see that it is the case. So this is simply because you can compute everything in this case. You set theta j to be the coefficient of a function j on the basis phi j. And you see that minimizing this quantity here amounts to minimize the corresponding quantity for the element of small l2. Theta belongs to small l2. And you see that it amounts to minimize minus 2 times the double products which are here and which appear because of you just have expanded the norm square of the difference between f and j. So there is the part which does not influence the minimization in which is the sum of the coefficient square. So you forget about it, and you have the double product plus the sum of the square and plus the quantity which comes from the penalty, from the regularization term, and which is this one. And you see that minimizing this quantity in small l2 amounts to minimize this quantity for each coordinate. And for each coordinate, coordinate by coordinate, if you minimize this, you discover that the theta tilde j, which is the minimizer here, is just the quantity which such that the derivative with respect to theta j here is equal to zero. And so you see that there is a two which appears everywhere. It is present here. And it appears when you derive this quantity with respect to theta j, and this one also. And so you see that the equation which gives you theta tilde j is just f scalar products with phi j, which comes from here, with a minus, plus theta tilde j multiplied by 1, which comes from here, plus lambda j to the power 2r, and it is equal to 0. And this leads you to the solution that is theta tilde j equals f scalar products with phi j over 1 plus lambda j to the power 2r. Okay, so the message here is that the regularizer is explicitly computable. So now we can look at the noisy version. The noisy version amounts to replace the distance square by the n epsilon j criterion. But apart from that, you do exactly the same as before, and you define the regularization in the statistical framework this time. That is a framework where you do not know f at all, and you have this noisy version at disposal to build an estimator. And the regularizer this time will be an estimator. So once again, the regularization parameter lambda has to be chosen at the end of the day. And once again, this term of regularization comes from the fact that you have this Sobolev example where you see that in this case, you define an estimator which is smoother than the original function. So let us consider again the generic example where you take a basis, a Hilbert basis, and we take as a regularization space the set of those j such that the sum of the coefficient square times j to the power 2r is finite, and with the regularization norm which is defined like that. Then in this case, exactly as in the deterministic case, you can compute explicitly the estimator, and it is merely the sum of the empirical coefficients this time divided by the same quantity as before, that is 1 plus lambda j to the power 2r times phi j. I do not make the proof again, it is the same as in the deterministic case. So again, in this case, the regularizer is explicitly computable. The estimator, which is defined through this regularization procedure, is explicitly computable. So now, formally, the link with model selection comes from the following simple formula. When you look at the infimum of the least square criterion plus lambda times the regularization norm square, if you compute this infimum, this is what you are doing when you compute the regularization estimator. When you do that, you can do it starting from making the job in two steps. You can first look at the infimum of the criterion in a ball and then optimize the radius of the ball. And if you do that, you end up with the same value of the infimum as before. And you see here now that you have made a collection appear, and which is a collection of models, which is a continuous collection of models, in fact, which are merely the balls with radius r and the balls with respect to this regularization semi-norm. And of course, in the generic example that we have given, that is in the example where the semi-norm is defined through the Hilbert basis, then you see that these balls are merely ellipsoids. And so you see now that there is a connection, a simple connection between regularization and the issue of choosing a proper ellipsoid. So the issue of model selection, when you take as a collection of models, homothetics of the same ellipsoid. So exactly the situation that we have looked before, apart from the fact that here you have a continuous collection of models and we have analyzed a discrete collection of models. But this is not important, in fact, because this discrete collection of models is very close to the continuous one. And you just have to use the fact that our model selection theorem is robust to approximation, to minimization at delta, up to some quantity delta. If you look at the statement and the proof of the theorem, the general theorem that you have proved, the general model selection that you have proved, if the you look at a minimizer up to some additive quantity delta, this delta, you will end up with a risk bound which involves this delta at the end of the day, and this does not influence at all the whole procedure. This means that you do not need the minimizer to be exact minimizer. If you have minimizer up to some additive constant, it's not an issue. You have to take care of the fact that this additive constant is not too large in order that it appears in the remainder term of the risk bound. But apart from that, it's painless. So this is exactly what we take into account here. If we start from the regularizer, so what I call the regularizer is the F tilde lambda, which is the minimizer of the regularization procedure. If we start from it, we just look at a model. You define M hat to be the smallest integer such that the regularizer belongs to the ellipsoid S M hat. And by definition of the regularizer, when you look at the penalized criterion here, it is always smaller than the infimum of the criterion L epsilon of j belonging to Sn plus 2 lambda m square epsilon square plus 2 lambda epsilon square for all value of m. We just have to take into account that possibly you have, because of the discretization, you have this effect that the penalty has to be taken slightly larger than what you could think. And this means that the penalty is maybe defined through m plus 1 square rather than m square. So you just come back to m square by saying that m plus 1 square is less than 2m square plus 2. And this is the reason why you make this 2 lambda n square epsilon square and this 2 lambda epsilon square appear. But apart from this effect of the discretization, you have exactly what you expect, that is, the regularizer is, in fact, the solution of our model selection procedure on the whole collection of ellipsoids at the same time. And this shows that a penalized D-square estimator on this collection, this shows that the regularizer is up to some additive error, of course, a convenient solution to the penalized D-square estimation procedure on the collection of discrete models, up to this additive error. And so at the end of the day, we have a performance which is given by our theorem, and which shows that if you take the regularization parameter in a way that it is of the right order with respect to the minimum risk on the ellipsoid, that is, we take the regularization parameter as a constant time the right power of epsilon in order that this power reflects the minimum risk on the ellipsoid. Then if you do that, at the end of the day, the constraint on the penalty that we have in the theorem is satisfied when you take the penalty as you have to take it in the regularization procedure. So take care of the fact that it is slightly different from the constraint. You see that the constraint is defined through a power of n, which is not n squared. It is n to the power 2 over 2 a plus 1. But of course, this power is less than 2. So this means that the constraint is less stringent than the value that you have taken here in the penalty. So the penalty, which comes from the regularization procedure, is larger than the constraint that we have in the theorem. And this is important. You will see it in a moment. So we can apply our theorem, because our theorem does not, in the statement of the theorem, we have a constraint which specifies that the penalty has to be bigger than something, but you can take something which is bigger than the constraint. So this is the case here, which is the penalty as we have to do it in order to interpret the regularization procedure as a penalized procedure. And at the end, we get a result which says that the performance of the regularizer is given by the following formula. We come back to the continuous version because it is easier to analyze. And so we have the distance squared between the target and the ball with respect to the regularization subnorm. Excuse me, there is a mistake here. This is not, the R is here. So this is the regularization norm square less than capital R square. This is the ball. And you have this, which is quite satisfactory because you have put in the machine a penalty, which is lambda times R square. And at the end, you get it in the bound. So this is exactly what you expect. And now, if you try to analyze it in terms of adaptivity in the minimax sense, so it's quite interesting to do that. In this case, the ball is an ellipsoid, of course. It is given by the ellipsoid with radiuses, which are given by capital R times j to the power minus r. And you discover that uniformly over this ball, the risk bound for the regularization estimator is given by this quantity. And what is important is that as a power of epsilon, this is okay. This corresponds to what you should get in the minimax risk, but it is no longer the case for the power with respect to R. This is not okay. This is a suboptimal power. But of course, this is structural, that is, this R square is there because you are looking at regularization. And it's important, if you come back to the definition, to the computation of the regularizer, if you come back to that, look at here, the power square is very important because if you were working with another power, what you would get here is something which would not be computable, because here, if you would put something like this to the power 1 over 2r plus 1, if you put it to the power 1 over 2r plus 1, you really see that you completely destroy the structure and you can no longer compute the estimator as easily as in the case where you put a power 1 here. So you see that the consideration that we have followed in order to define the regularization is driven by our will to get a computable estimator at the end of the day. And the price to pay in order to get something which is computable is that the power which is involved here, excuse me, the power which is involved here is no longer the right power. The right power should be R to the power 2 over 2R plus 1. This would be the right power. As far as the order of the minimax risk is concerned. So this is what I have summarized here. This is a correct order for the minimax risk as a function of epsilon, but it is too large as a function of R. It should be R to the power 2 over 2R plus 1. So you see that the message here is that this regularization procedure leads to some computable estimator, but the price to pay is that you do not get a fully adaptive estimator in the minimax sense, just because you have this power of R, which is involved and which is suboptimal. And it can be shown that it is structural. That is, you can show that this power of R is indeed the right, the R square is indeed the right order of magnitude for the risk of the regularization procedure. So this is really the price to pay in order to be computable. Okay, so this is it. I stop here for today. I have announced at the beginning that it would be a shorter lecture than usual. And I would like to wish you a Merry Christmas. And I hope to see you again after the Christmas break. And as usual, I will send you all the material, and I will put the lecture, the recorded lecture, on YouTube.